Hey everybody, this is Ibarionex from the Candid Frame, and Happy New Year. Thanks for joining me again. Thanks for all the great responses that you provided for the video that I did previously with Olaf Staba. We've got some wonderful feedback on it, and hopefully Olaf will be back to do another critique with me in the future, and possibly some other photographers are going to play around with the format a little bit. But it's me solo again, but I hope you don't mind that, and hopefully I can provide you some, you know, some good insights with respect to photography. Before we start with the video, again, another reminder, my new book, Making Photographs, Developing a Personal Visual Workflow, is out and available. You can get a 40% discount from the list price when you go to the Rocky Nook website and use the promo code PORELLO40, and you can get a discount off of the ebook, the soft cover, or actually both. So if you like the book, let me know and write a review, and let's get on to the pictures. Now, one of the things that I wanted to do today, because it's the start of a new year, is that, you know, at the beginning of every new year, people are very enthusiastic, especially if they purchase a new camera, with the idea that this year they're going to go out and they're going to produce a lot more photographs and try to improve their skills as a photographer. But I, as anyone else, often face the challenge of just finding the time to shoot. And one of the things that I've been doing a lot is just photographing at home, if not close to home. Just not so much because I think it's the most interesting subject matter in the world, but sometimes it's just good practice, because if I can find something interesting to shoot in my own home, it allows me to practice my seeing, my picture taking, my post-processing, without having to wait days or weeks until I get to, you know, some interesting location in which to make photographs. I try to do this every day, and I encourage you to do the same. And so with that in mind, I chose three pictures that could have been taken at home. Maybe not all of them were, but it'll probably give you some food for thought with respect to how and when you make photographs. All right, here we have a shot by John Krumm. This was made with the Pentax K1 at 1/20th of a second, f4.5, ISO 400. And the caption he has for this is "Records Played on Christmas." And it's just an assortment of old records on a chair or a couch with a carpet in the background. And you see all these record albums in the upper right-hand corner and then on the seat here. And I thought that this was a really kind of interesting image to start with, because there are a lot of objects in our apartments or in our homes that are really personal items. Items that really reflect our interests, our passions, our loves, and if not our own, that of our family members. And oftentimes, things like this don't get photographed. Now, if I'm doing a photo story on someone else, I will typically look for these little details as a way of exploring who this person is. I don't just want to make photographs of their faces and their bodies. I want to include little details of their environment to help sort of flesh out who this person is. And I think we miss out on the opportunity to do that with ourselves, because we live with ourselves all the time. We don't think that we're particularly interesting. But if you sort of take the step back and start looking at ourselves as a subject, all of a sudden, there are little things that help to define our living space that can become really interesting photographs, especially when, as in this case, you have an interesting quality of light that's coming in through the window that sort of, you know, washes over the scene and then recedes to shadow on the left-hand side. The shapes of the records are really a really strong graphic element in this shot, which serve as a sort of a counterpoint to the harder, edgier lines that pervade the frame. But it's this mishmash of different elements that really give you an insight into, you know, John's space, not only from the choice of records, but, you know, the choice of the furniture, the rug. All of those things as part of a photo story could be really, really interesting. And though he's probably not doing a photo story on himself, he was just documenting little elements of his Christmas day. This is really good practice for when you do photograph someone else and you're doing environmental portraits, or you are trying to produce a little photo essay on them, to just look at your own world and see not only what you can photograph, but what can you photograph in an interesting way. And I think that the shapes, the light, obviously the colors, really make for an interesting composition. And even though we don't see a human figure in the frame other than the portrait on the album cover in the upper left-hand corner, we have a really strong sense of the presence of the person just by the elements that we get to see in the composition. So think about your own space and how you might consider photographing it in a really interesting way and not just take it for granted just because it's yours. Okay, here we have a shot by C. Smith. This was made on film on Kodak Portra 400 on a Bronica ETRS, so we don't have any XF data here. Now, I really like the beauty of this scene, largely because of the light and the way that it just, you know, just moves through this entire scene and the subtle gradation of light to shadow. It's really, really beautiful. But I don't know whether this is in a home, whether it's maybe an RV or maybe a bed and breakfast somewhere. In any case, that doesn't matter. What matters is the way that, you know, the photographer here leveraged the light and all those different elements in the scene. And it brought to mind, for me, the many times that I've photographed in my kitchen, because my kitchen faces out to the east. And so in the mornings, I get this wonderful quality of light. And I have photographed so much in that kitchen. I've photographed my wife, my mother-in-law, different friends and relatives that have come to visit. I've photographed my breakfast, my coffee, things that are in the sink, because the light is just absolutely just amazing. And it's the quality of the light and the way that it just renders the colors and the shapes that really appeals to me in this photograph. And I want to challenge you to think about your own space. Think about, what's it like in the early mornings or in the late afternoon? What rooms benefit from a real wonderful quality of light at different times of the day? What are the elements in that room during that time? And how does the light affect the way that you perceive it? It's ordinary stuff, mundane stuff that we don't really take much care in seeing. They all serve a purpose in our living space. We never think about them photographically. But like the image before, just by observing what's happening with the light, seeing where the shadows are, seeing how colors and shapes and lines and all those different things are transformed as a result of the quality of light that you have to work with, is a great opportunity for you as a photographer. Because if you can tune yourself into being able to see to that degree when it's your own living space, when you go and photograph elsewhere, you will have developed that skill set. You will have practiced it to the point that you're able to recognize it almost immediately. If you only get to practice that when you're going out on vacation or you go out every couple of weekends to shoot, it's a really hard skill to build on and to refine. But if you're using your own living space, your own working space, even the space that you occupy as you are commuting from point A to point B as part of your work or part of your errands, you're practicing something that becomes absolutely essential to your seeing and to your picture taking. And as you can see here, it's really all about the light and observing the light. The flowers and the vase and the curtains, those are all wonderful things. But It's the quality of the light and the way that the photographer rendered it that really makes it a really nice moment, even though, like the previous image, there's nobody in the frame. Here we have a shot by a fellow whose name I'm not even going to try and pronounce. I think it's NX Lutz in 2. Don't have any XF data in here. Now, this is a really interesting shot because what it is, it's a window and there is a curtain or a blind in front of the window, but the light is passing along the edges of the blind onto the ceiling. And this shot, it's all about paying attention to the light and seeing how the light is shaped and defined as a result of the blind. Now, stuff like this happens everywhere. It happens in my office. It happens at home. Wherever you live, wherever you have something that sort of blocks the sunlight, in the morning or in the afternoon when that light is sort of peeking, literally peeking through or past those obstructions that we put in front of windows, the light does an amazing little dance on the walls and on the ceilings. And how many times do you pay attention to that? And it's a really subtle thing, right? Because this picture is not about a wall. It's not about a window. It's not about a blind. It's all about the light. The light and the shadow and the pattern that is created as a result of the way the light is affected as a result of that obstruction. This is a scene that is ordinary and as mundane as anything. But because of the way the photographer has observed it, it informed the way that he made the photograph and shot as a result. I guarantee you that all of you could find a scene like this in your own home. At some point, the light creeps in and it does something interesting and wonderful in your house. And it may touch on more than just a wall or ceiling. There may be a ceramic, a coffee mug, an ashtray, whatever it is. And then when the light hits that, it transforms it into something more than whatever function that that object serves in your normal day-to-day. And at that point, that's when the photographer mind clicks in and you realize, oh my God, this thing has the potential of being a really interesting photograph, even though the basic elements are just absolutely ordinary. And that, I think, is the biggest challenge for any photographer, is to be able to look that precisely, that carefully, to be open to any possibility, even in our own homes, and leveraging that and practicing our photography as a result. Because I can guarantee you that if you become adept at being able to make those discoveries in your own home, when you go out into the street or you travel elsewhere or you're doing a photo story or a photo essay on someone else, you will be in your groove almost immediately because you've practiced it on the one subject that you have access to all the time, which is yourself. All right. I hope that's helpful to you. This is something that I'm really trying to do in my own life every day. I am trying to find something around my house that I can photograph in a different way. And it is a challenge. It can kick my butt sometimes. And sometimes I don't succeed in making a good photograph, but I'm always, always looking so that when I do go out and I do have something that I'm either, you know, doing on assignment or as part of a personal project, I know that I'm on top of my, you know, on the top of my game with respect to trying to make as good a photograph as possible. So, if you have just found us and you've never heard of The Candid Frame is a podcast, which I've been doing going on now 13 years, and it features conversations with some of the world's best photographers. We just finished interviewing David Burnett, who is probably one of the best photojournalists we have in the world. He's photographed every president since Kennedy, every Olympic game since the 84 Olympics in Los Angeles. He has been everywhere and photographed everybody. And it's a conversation you don't want to miss because he has some great stories to tell. I could probably talk to him for about 3 hours and still not gotten, you know, a smidgen of the stories that this man has to tell. But, you know, given that the show is usually about an hour, I think that you still will get an hour's worth of really great insights and stories from a great photographer. And you can find out more about that by visiting thecandidframe.com. And if you like what you're seeing here on this YouTube channel, give us a thumbs up, subscribe, and I'll see you next time.